Well, good evening, and welcome to our Sunday night live stream. Let's all worship him together, for he is worthy of all our praise. No matter where we are, we will worship him, for God is good. Lord, you are so good and worthy of all our praise. We will lift up your name. You are so good, so kind. We love you, Lord. We do love you. In your holy and precious name we pray. Amen.
No height or depth can separate. Steadfast love who can escape.
You are.
Everything that we are, everything that we believe in, Lord, everything that we think gives us strength, everything that we trust in this world, Lord, we surrender it all and give it all to you, Lord, because we know that you, Lord, are sovereign. We know that you are the one who watches over us, who takes care of us. You're our protector. You're our shield. You're our heavenly Father, Lord. And for for that reason, Lord, we surrender it all. We give it all to you, Lord. So, Lord, take our lives in your hands. Take us in your arms, Lord. Hold us, Lord. Show us your ways. Show us your love. Show us your kindness, your grace, and your salvation, Lord. Lord, have your way in us. Be with us, Lord. Love you. We praise you, Lord. In your holy and precious name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Well, good evening. Glad you could join us tonight for our study in Genesis chapter 42 as we consider the providence of God in a message I've entitled Sovereign Lord. And so if you have your Bibles, why don't you open them to Genesis chapter 42, and if you don't have a Bible, why don't you get one and open it to Genesis 42 so you can follow along with us in our study tonight. Just a couple of things before we get into our study. First of all, continue to keep the Marquez family in prayer as Chris battles with the COVID-19. She is doing well. She's sequestered to her bedroom, and she is recovering, but it's a long, slow process, and so pray that she wouldn't relapse and go backwards in this thing, and pray for Jesus and the kids as he continues to be Mr. Mom and continues to care for them, and pray for Jesus' parents as they have sequestered themselves to their bedroom, and they don't have it yet. They haven't tested for it or anything, but keep them in prayer because they are a high-risk category. They're about 70-ish years old, so continue to pray for them. So let's go to the Lord in prayer, and let's get into our study tonight. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the things that you have in store for us tonight, and we pray, Lord, that you would speak to our hearts, Lord, that you would minister in power as we consider these truths in Genesis chapter 42. Lord, we love you. We pray that you would do a mighty work in our hearts, and you would continue to strengthen us and to use us for your glory in these times. And Lord, we love you, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So after years of suffering as a slave and an inmate after betrayal by his brothers, Jacob has finally experienced the fact, though he always kind of knew it, he's experiencing the fact that God had an incredible plan for his life, and he's now starting to walk in it. Genesis 42 brings us to the climax, if you would, of God's plan, because he was going to use Joseph to preserve the nation of Israel that they might one day bring in the Messiah, the Savior of the world. And so we're going to see the sovereignty of God in action. We're going to see the providence of God as he accomplishes his plans in order to bring salvation to you and to me. Verse 1, when Jacob saw that there was grain in Egypt, Jacob said to his sons, "Why do you look at one another?" Now, there are no crops in Israel, in Canaan. There's no grain for the livestock. 4 meat plants have shut down due to coronavirus, and now there's a danger of meat shortages. I'm sorry, wrong famine, sorry. But they're all sitting around staring at each other. Why are they staring at each other? Maybe they're wondering what to do next, or maybe they're wrestling with a guilty conscience, as we'll see in a minute, knowing that Joseph was in Egypt while Jacob is talking about going to Egypt. And he said, Jacob said, verse 2, "Indeed, I've heard that there's grain in Egypt. Go down to that place and buy for us there that we may live and not die." Now, this is a beautiful picture of what it means to exercise faith. Well, what do you mean? Jacob heard that there was grain in Egypt, and he acted upon what he heard. You see, if anybody wonders what it means to be saved by faith, they can understand it easily from what Jacob did right here. He heard and he believed, and that belief was demonstrated in the fact that he acted, in what he did. And that's what faith in Christ is all about. You heard that he died on the cross for your sins. You heard that he paid a price you could never pay. And you might even say you believe it. but you have no faith until you act upon it. It's all talk until you do something about it. Paul said, if you confess with your mouth, Romans chapter 10, verse 9, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. You see, there's that believing, but it's demonstrated in that confessing, in that inviting Jesus to be your Lord and Savior. That's how you know you really believe. You act upon it. Now, Jacob had said, I heard that there's grain in Egypt. But he didn't send the boys to check it out. That would not be faith. That would be a lack of faith. No matter how much he insisted he believed there was grain in Egypt, he and his family would still go hungry because he never acted upon it. They would still starve. So verse 3, so Joseph's 10 brothers went down to buy grain in Egypt. But Jacob did not send Joseph's brother Benjamin with his brothers, for he said, lest some calamity befall him. Now, Joseph and Benjamin were brothers from the same mother, right? Remember, they were the two sons born to Rachel, so that they were full brothers. And notice that he was the youngest. He was only about 10 when Joseph was sold into slavery, so it's almost certain that he had nothing to do with what happened to his brother. They were close. They were tight-knit brothers. And the sons of Israel, verse 5, went to buy grain among those who journeyed, for the famine was in the land of Canaan. Now Joseph was governor over the land, and it was he who sold to all the people of the land. And Joseph's brothers came and bowed down before him with their faces to the earth. Now apparently many from Canaan came down because the famine was so severe. Extra biblical fact, this was the 19th famine in the history of Canaan, so they called it famine 19. Just kidding, I totally made that up. But they all had to, crack myself up. They all had to go through Joseph when they got to Egypt. And as second in command in Israel, apparently he was sort of the immigration department as well, so some called him the famine 19 czar, like Vice President Pence. Verse 7, Joseph saw his brothers and recognized them, but he acted as a stranger to them and spoke roughly to them. Then he said to them, where do you come from? And they said, from the land of Canaan to buy food. So Joseph recognized his brothers, but they did not recognize him. Now I wonder if Joseph didn't flash back to his childhood dreams. Remember when he dreamed that his brother's sheaves would bow down to his sheaf, and you know, as they would bow down to him. And 21 years have passed since that dream, but here they are, the same guys who said in Genesis 37, verse 8, shall you indeed reign over us, or shall you indeed have dominion over us? He was 17 when he was sold, and now here he was, 38 years old. And he's dressed as the ruler of Egypt. They would never have thought to look for their brother there. They may have looked all around, hoping they don't run into him, but they would have never thought to look for him there as second in command of all of Egypt. So he recognized them, but they didn't recognize him. Then Joseph remembered the dreams which he had dreamed about them, see, and said to them, you are spies. You have come to see the nakedness of the land. And they said to him, no, my lord, but your servants have come to buy food. We're all one man's sons. We are honest men. Your servants are not spies. But he said to them, no, but you've come to see the nakedness of the land. And they said, your servants are 12 brothers, the sons of one man in the land of Canaan. And in fact, the youngest is with our father today, and one is no more. Now they're referring to Joseph, who they sold in slavery. But Joseph said to them, it is as I spoke to you, saying, you are spies. So he's really putting the screws to his brothers. This is not a form of entertainment for Joseph. He's not enjoying this any more than the Lord enjoys putting us through the things he has to put us through for disciplinary reasons at times. He doesn't have fun watching us suffer. There's always a purpose behind it, and there's a purpose behind what Joseph is doing. In this manner, he said, verse 15, you shall be tested. By the life of Pharaoh, you shall not leave this place unless your youngest brother comes here. Send one of you and let him bring your brother, and you shall be kept in prison, that your words may be tested to see whether there is any truth in you. Or else, by the life of Pharaoh, surely you are spies. So he put them all together in prison 3 days. And this is nothing compared to what they went through, what he went through at their hands. So I don't think that they have any room to complain about what he did. Then Joseph said to them the third day, do this and live, for I fear God. Verse 19, if you are honest men, let one of your brothers be confined to your prison house. But you, go and carry grain for the famine of your houses. And bring your youngest brother to me, so your words will be verified, and you shall not die. And they did so. Then they said to one another, we are truly guilty concerning our brother. For we saw the anguish of his soul when he pleaded with us, and we would not hear. Therefore, this distress has come upon us. See, the brothers very much understood the law of sowing and reaping. Paul said in Galatians chapter 6, verse 7, God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. And they were reaping what they sowed. They recognized it right away. And Reuben answered them, saying, did I not speak to you, saying, do not sin against the boy? And you wouldn't listen. Therefore, behold, his blood is now required of us. See, Reuben said, I told you so. Over 20 years have passed, and they're still deeply feeling the pain of their guilt. And a guilty conscience will nag you until the day you die. And it won't simply go away. It won't fall off, no matter how much you try to drown it out. Even time doesn't dissipate the pain of a guilty conscience. Back in 1811, the U.S. Treasury Department established a gift account called the Conscience Fund. Since its inception in 1811, people have sent in, mostly anonymously, approximately $5.7 million. Many of the donations have been sent in by pastors who received the money in deathbed confessions. Now, there's certainly room to question how sincere people are in their desire to make things right. One anonymous giver sent a check in for $1,000, and with it, he attached a note that read, dear Internal Revenue Service, I have not been able to sleep at night because I cheated on last year's income tax. Enclosed, find a cashier's check for $1,000. If I still can't sleep, I'll send you the balance. You know, many believe that the guilty conscience is attached to a desire to be punished. The behavior of the guilty person begins to change, and he starts to become hurtful and rude to others around him, to those who love him, and they begin to distance themselves, and the guilty person begins to feel that he's getting the punishment he deserves. And these brothers carried this guilt around for 21 years, and as soon as they got in trouble, they immediately thought about how they wronged their brother, how they were getting what they deserved. They longed for that punishment. Verse 23, but they did not know that Joseph understood them, for he spoke to them through an interpreter. And he turned himself away from them and wept. Then he returned to them again and talked with them. And he took Simeon from them and bound him before their eyes. Interesting he picked Simeon, because remember, Simeon was cruel and was probably the ringleader in selling Joseph. But Joseph was weeping as he listened to his brothers. He knew the fate of the world was wrapped up in this motley crew. He knew that he was placed there by God to preserve them alive, but the question remained in his own heart as to their ability to carry out the responsibility that God would place upon them. Did they have the character to be the ones who brought in the Messiah, to be that nation that would be God's nation? They had been a wicked bunch, and Jacob knew that this had to be addressed. And one of the signs that they were starting to genuinely want to change is their confession. Confession is always the beginning of true repentance. That's why John says if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Because that confession is the beginning of true repentance. They no longer sought to cover their sins or to justify their sins, but they confessed their sins. The Bible says, Solomon wrote in Proverbs 28:13, "He who covers his sin will not prosper, but whoever confesses and forsakes them will have mercy." And so, when John said that if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, he was saying, hey, here's the beginning of being free. Here's the beginning of not having to live with this guilty conscience, of not having to carry this pain of what you did. It's not until we come to confession that we can truly begin to deal with our guilt. So verse 25, then Joseph gave a command to fill their sacks with grain, to restore every man's money to his sack, and to give them provisions for the journey. So he's pulling a mischievous trick on them. Thus he did for them. So they loaded their donkeys with the grain and departed from there. But as one of them opened his sack to give his donkey feed at the encampment, he saw his money. And there it was, in the mouth of the sack. So he said to his brothers, my money's been restored, and there it is in my sack. And can you imagine how he jumped out of his robe that moment? Then their hearts failed them, and they were afraid, saying to one another, what is this that God had done to us? I just wonder if Joseph started to laugh as they rode off, knowing that they'd freak out when they found that money in their sack. Verse 29, then they went to Jacob, their father, in the land of Canaan, and told him all that had happened to them, saying, the man who is lord of the land spoke roughly to us and took us for spies of the country. But we said to him, we're honest men, we're not spies. We're 12 brothers, sons of our father. One is no more, and the youngest is with our father this day in the land of Canaan. Then the man, the lord of the country, said to us, by this I will know that you're honest men. Leave one of your brothers here with me. Take food for the famine of your households and be gone. And bring your youngest brother to me, so I shall know that you're not spies, but that you are honest men. I'll grant your brother to you, and you may trade in the land. Then it happened as they emptied their sacks that surprisingly each man's bundle of money was in his sack. And when they and their father saw the bundles of money, they were afraid. Oh, man, they were terrified. Jacob suspected his sons had ripped off the man in Egypt, and now he's really in trouble. Jacob said, their father said to them, you have bereaved me. Jacob is no more. Simeon is no more. And now you want to take Benjamin? All these things are against me. But that's not true, Jacob. You see, all these things were not against him. As he was looking at his circumstances, he found himself hopeless. He saw the money. He heard the story of the roughness of the Lord of Egypt. He heard the demand of that man, and because fear took over, he began to despair, because fear always leads to despair. And when despair takes over, we often do regrettable things. Notice Jacob first lashed at his sons, who in this case did nothing wrong, though he accused them of doing wrong. He began to exaggerate his situation. I need to stock up on toilet paper right now. You know, all these things are against me. It just seemed that way. But he was measuring the problem against what he could see instead of recognizing the unseen. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 4:18, we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Had Jacob seen things through God's eyes, he would have known that none of these things were against him. He would have rejoiced and said, all these things are for me. But you might say, how could he have seen things through God's eyes? But what you're really asking, if you are asking that question, is how can I see things through God's eyes? You see, right now I'm looking at this coronavirus epidemic, pandemic. I'm looking at the fact that I haven't had a paycheck in weeks. I'm looking at the fact that there's a lot more month than money in my life. I'm looking at the fact that I don't know if I'm even going to go back to a job in a few weeks. I'm looking at the fact that my loved ones are getting sick, and some of them are even dying. I'm looking at a nation, at a world that's falling apart. How is this COVID-19 stuff going to work out for me and not against me? How can I know that this unemployment is somehow going to work for my good? The answer is through His Word. Because we have His promise in Romans chapter 8, verse 28. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to His purpose. It doesn't mean we won't suffer. Joseph certainly did. The brothers certainly did. Jacob suffered greatly. His heart was grieved for 21 years. It does mean that when we do suffer, God will work that suffering out for our good and the good of those around us, the good of His kingdom. If only Jacob had stopped to think about God's promises to him before he complained, he would have had a completely different mindset when he looked at this situation. Our problem is we forget God's promises. We forget the things that God said to us, and we fail to believe those things. And so we start to say, all these things are against us. But reality is, though we don't see it, all these things are for us. So, verse 37, Reuben spoke to his father, saying, kill my two sons if I don't bring them back to you. Put them in my hands and I'll bring them back to you. See, this is really dumb. Reuben, Jacob will later say, is unstable as water. And kind of a knucklehead. He says, if my sons fail, if I fail you, Dad, kill your grandsons. Now, I don't know about you, but if my sons fail me, I won't take any comfort in killing my grandkids. That's just not going to be a source of satisfaction or peace or joy for me. But Reuben was just saying something really stupid to say something at the moment. And unfortunately, we do that sometimes. We say dumb things when we should have just been quiet and practiced presence ministry, just being there with others. Verse 38, but he said, my son shall not go down with you, for his brother is dead and he is left alone. If any calamity should befall him along the way in which you go, then you would bring down my gray hair with sorrow to the grave. And so this is to be continued. We'll finish this story next week. I just think it's great that we can laugh at Jacob because our faith never fails, because we're so solid in our faith. But let's learn from Jacob and let's recognize that all these things, even our suffering, even COVID-19, is working for us an eternal weight of glory. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for these things that you've shown us. And Lord, as we close this time of study, I pray for any who have never put their trust in your Son. Lord, draw them to yourself. Grant them eternal life, forgiveness of sins. Listen, if you're not already doing so and you're a believer watching this live stream, I'm going to ask you to be in prayer right now as I speak to those who have not put their trust in Jesus as their Lord and Savior. You see, God does have a plan for you. If you're watching this live stream, it's proof of it. It's not coincidence, it's a divine appointment. God wanted you to hear this message because He wants you to know that He has a plan for your life. He did bring about the Savior, and Jesus came, and He lived for some 32 years on the earth, and then He died on the cross, not having ever committed a sin. Not because He deserved death, but because we deserved it. He died not as a martyr, but as a sacrifice for our sins. And the Bible says if you believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins and you believe that he rose again from the dead, that you can have eternal life. You can know that your sins are forgiven and you can know that you're pure as a driven snow in the sight of God just by putting your trust in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And if you want to do that, I want to pray with you right here, right now. As I pray these words, I just want you to repeat them after me. Make this your prayer because you believe it's true. And I'll pray a prayer with you to put your trust in Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Dear Lord Jesus, I believe you died on the cross for my sins. I believe you paid a price I could never pay. And you made a way for me to spend eternity with you. Lord Jesus, come into my life. Forgive me, for I am a sinner. Cleanse my heart. Make me new. Lord Jesus, I put my trust in you this day. And I thank you for what you've done. And Father, I pray for those who have prayed this prayer that you would pour out your Spirit upon them in power, baptize them in your Holy Spirit even now, Lord. And I pray that you would do incredible things in their life as they grow in their relationship with you, Lord. Cause them to fall in love with you as they recognize what an awesome Savior you are. Lord, we love you. Be glorified in us. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Hey, listen, if you just prayed this prayer, I want to encourage you to click on that little button next to the live stream there underneath it if you're on YouTube that says, I just prayed to receive Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And I want you to let us know who you are so that we can send you a little booklet that tells you about what to do next. And if you need a Bible, let us know and we'll send you a Bible. But more than anything, we can pray for you and ask the Lord to just help you and as you grow as a believer. And so may the Lord pour out his Spirit upon you. May he bless you beyond exceedingly abundantly above anything you can ask or think. And may he make you wise in these days of darkness in Jesus' precious name. David's going to send us home now. God bless you all.
Jesus, Lord.
great night. God bless you all. See you all on Wednesday.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. Above my